I'd like to talk to you about the godly family. Today, the family is being attacked in so many different ways, so many different areas of life, but especially when it comes to the Bible and creation. You know, I want to show you here what President Obama said. Now, by no means am I trying to tell you who you should vote for here. I'm simply saying Obama does not understand Christianity. Look what he says here.
Which passages of Scripture should guide our public policy? Should we go with Leviticus, which suggests slavery is okay? Or we could go with Deuteronomy, which suggests stoning your child if he strays from the faith? Or should we just stick to the Sermon on the Mount, a passage that is so radical that it's doubtful that our own Defense Department would survive its application? Folks haven't been reading their Bible.
You see, obviously he does not understand the Bible. What he's saying is that we can't understand, you know, are we supposed to live our lives according to Leviticus or Matthew? You know, our defense system wouldn't handle that. This shows that he doesn't understand the Scriptures, and I'm afraid that that's the way many people in the church are. They don't have an understanding of the Bible. They don't read their Bible. They don't study it. Therefore, they don't know it. And therefore, when they do get little pieces, they don't understand the context of it, and as a result, they make up their own interpretation of Scripture rather than letting the Scriptures interpret that Scripture. And this is something that we have to be very careful about. Look what Matt Damon says here, discussing Sarah Palin way back when she was running for vice president.
Crazy. I need to know if she really thinks dinosaurs were here 4,000 years ago. That's an important, I want to know that. I really do. Because she's going to have the nuclear codes. You know, I want to know if she thinks dinosaurs were here 4,000 years ago.
Really? I mean, if she believes that dinosaurs lived, you know, 4,000 years ago, she's nuts. She's going to be having the nuclear codes. Well, guess what? Then I'm nuts. I'm crazy because I believe dinosaurs walked this earth only 4,000 years ago. And if you don't know that, get the DVD, Dinosaurs, Ice Age, and the Pre-Flood World. There is so much evidence from science to show you that, but we're living in a society that won't even allow you to believe what Scripture says. Without saying, you're crazy. You can't even be in politics. You can't even be a scientist. You can't believe in science if you believe in creation. We live in a society where here we have Mary Williams, a staff writer for Salon Magazine. Look what she says. Throughout my own pregnancies, I never wavered for a moment the belief that I was carrying a human life inside of me. I believe that's what a fetus is, a human life. And that doesn't make me one iota less solidly pro-choice. If by some random fluke I learned today I was pregnant, you bet your blank I'd have an abortion. I'd have the world's greatest abortion. This is how we value family today. She's saying, I'd abort a kid because I don't want it. I would take my own needs over theirs. That's evolution for you right there. Evolution is saying there are no laws. We make up our own rules, our own desires. You know, I'm definitely pro-life, but you know, here's the problem. The pro-life saying, well, this is life, isn't going to win the argument, is it? She's saying, I know it's life, I just don't care. I know it's life, it just doesn't matter. You see, only the gospel of God, only the Scriptures, the Holy Spirit, is going to be able to keep your kids on the straight and narrow. Because the logical aspects don't matter anymore. It's the Word of God that is going to make the difference. How about Dr. Lawrence Krauss here from Arizona State University? He is being groomed to replace or, you know, take over for Richard Dawkins ultimately. He's going to be the new Richard Dawkins, they say. And he tells us that creation is child abuse. If you're going to teach your kids about creation and what I'm going to teach you, then I'm abusing your children. Look what he says.
The United States stated that teaching creationism is child abuse, and I think it is. Namely, if you withhold knowledge or you do anything to children that puts them at a competitive disadvantage as adults, it's child abuse. It's mild forms of child abuse, but it's like withholding medicine, withholding knowledge that later on will cause kids to become less competitive because evolution is the basis of modern biology, and teaching things that are basically lies, even if they're well-intentioned, is child abuse. I mean, people, it's not that people are doing this to be evil, but they're hurting their children, especially, of course, telling kids they're going to go to hell. That's definitely child abuse. It is inappropriate, and teachers not only should not be doing this, but in fact, if they are, they should be removed, in my opinion, because the purpose of education, as I've often said, is not to validate ignorance, but to overcome it.
Yeah, can you believe that? We should be able to, yet you can send your kids off to these universities, and I got news for you, it's not just him that's telling us this. There are many professors saying the same thing, even in Nebraska, at UNK. You bet. And so we protect our kids, and then we send them off to the college and throw them to the wolves, especially if you don't give them a foundation. Look what else Dr. Lawrence Krauss said here.
This is something that I wrote a whole book about, and someone asked me yesterday why I wrote that book. Because it is the most poetic thing I know about the universe. But the amazing thing is that every atom in your body came from a star that exploded. And the atoms in your left hand probably came from a different star than your right hand. It really is the most poetic thing I know about physics. You are all stardust. You couldn't be here if stars hadn't exploded, because the elements, the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, iron, all the things that matter for evolution, weren't created at the beginning of time. They're created in the nuclear furnaces of stars, and the only way they can get into your body is if the stars were kind enough to explode. So forget Jesus. The stars died so that you could be here today. Okay? And anyway.
Boy, if that isn't blasphemy, I don't know what is. And then the crowd erupts for it too, don't they? Yeah. This is the sad state in which society has become. You know, forget Jesus, the stars died for you. Our children need to be prepared with a godly foundation, or they will be destroyed by the wolves. Richard Dawkins even said this with respect to those meanings of human that are relevant to the morality of abortion: any fetus is less human than an adult pig. You pregnant women out here, what's inside you is less of a human being than an adult pig is. And these are the people teaching our children. These are the people influencing other professors in universities around our country. There is indeed a decline in the fall of America. You know, this is what else Obama said.
Whatever we once were, we are no longer a Christian nation. At least not just. We are also a Jewish nation, and a Muslim nation, and a Buddhist nation, and a Hindu nation, and a nation of non-believers.
I agree with him. I agree, we are no longer a Christian nation. Because we don't know our Bibles, we certainly don't obey it, what we do read. And we are not a Christian nation anymore. In order to be a godly family, we need to have Christ as the very center of that family. And so, I want to give you some practical advice here of how to raise a godly family. Now, by no means am I a perfect father. I don't want you to put me up on any pedestal here, because I'm not. But I think this is a very valuable presentation for us to understand, because we are living in a culture that we must fight against. We are living in a culture that wants to swallow up our children with technology and evolution, humanism, pornography. There's even websites out there like the National Center for Science Education. You go to their website, this is what it says they are. We are dedicated to keeping evolution and climate change in the science classroom and to keeping creationism and climate change denial out. That's their goal. And by the way, that's even for public schools, high schools that you're sending your children to right now. Your children, when they're being sent off to the public schools, even these elementary schools, I'll bet every one of your elementary kids that go to a public school, you ask them who Bill Nye the science guy is, they'll be able to tell you. Let me tell you what Bill Nye the science guy believes. He says this, I say to the grown-ups, if you want to deny evolution and live in your world, you know, that denies evolution, that's completely inconsistent with everything we observe in the universe, that's fine. But don't make your kids do it because we need them. We need scientifically literate voters and taxpayers for the future. We need people that can. We need engineers that can build stuff, solve problems. You know what he's saying? If you believe in creation and you're going to teach your children creation, they can't be engineers. They can't be scientists. They can't have the knack. What's the knack? Well, here, watch this video.
I'm worried about little Dilbert. He's not like other kids.
What do you mean?
Yesterday, I left him alone for a minute, and he disassembled the TV, our clock, and the stereo.
That's perfectly normal. Kids take things apart.
Ooh! The part that worries me is he used the components to build a ham radio set.
Oh, dear.
Is that bad?
Normally I'd want to run an EEG on him, but the machine isn't working. It's worse than I feared.
What is it?
I'm afraid your son has the knack.
The knack?
The knack. It's a rare condition characterized by an extreme intuition about all things mechanical and electrical, and utter social ineptitude.
Can he lead a normal life?
No. He'll be an engineer.
No!
There.
You see, it's a disease to be a true scientist, ultimately, guys. You're going to have a disease if you believe in creationism. Bill Nye went on and he said, my concern again is that we cannot afford to raise a substantial fraction of the next generation of students who do not have the skills to think scientifically. We're at a crossroads in history of the U.S. without scientifically literate kids. We'll fall behind other countries as inventors and innovators. We'll lose our edge. Yeah, you teach your kids creation. They can't invent anything. They can't be innovators. I'll show you in a moment that that's a lie. But here he is on Larry King.
Bill, those in the United States who publicly claim no religious affiliation have risen considerably over the last two decades. This recent shift, does it affect the interest in science?
Well,
if we go away from religion, do we go toward science?
I think what happens when you go toward science, you go away from religion. People get a lot out of religion. They get community. That's what people want.
And a feeling of something's coming.
And it's very hard to accept. For many of us, that when you die, it's over. That's really hard for a lot of people. But with that said, my concern has always been you can't use tax dollars intended for science education to teach something akin to the Earth is 10,000 years old. And to, because that's just wrong. I mean, it's very much analogous to saying the Earth is flat. I mean, that you can show the Earth is not flat. You can show the Earth is not 10,000 years old. Like, that's it. We're not teaching that in school.
So why do they continue to believe it?
So apparently, people with these deeply held religious beliefs, they embrace that whole literal interpretation of the Bible as written in English as a worldview. And at the same time, they accept aspirin, antibiotic drugs, airplanes, but they're able to hold these two worldviews. And this is a mystery.
The Bible as history book.
Bible is full of history, yeah. But it's not a science text.
It's not a science text.
Yeah.
It is full of history. It is full of the history of humanity and the evolution of culture. But it is not a scientific document.
Isn't that something? If you believe in aspirin, you know, why would you believe in creation? He's basically saying that, you know, we can't invent, we can't believe in real science if you believe in creation. Plus a number of other things that we could discuss in there that are certainly a fallacy. Look at all these scientific disciplines that we have. Every one of these with red arrows are showing you scientific disciplines that have been discovered by Bible-believing young Earth creationists. Every one of these, the airplane, the MRI machine was invented by a young Earth Bible-believing Christian. The invisible radar for the stealth bomber, invented by a Bible-believing young Earth creationist. How in the world can they do that? Because they certainly can't be an innovator, they can't be scientific, they can't be inventors if they believe in God and the Bible. But this is what your kids are being told. You can't be an engineer. If you're a creationist and an engineer, it's definitely a disease. Matthew Maury, he discovered oceanography. Why? Because the Bible said it was there. He said that if God said that there were paths in the seas, it should be possible to find them. So he spent his career discovering these paths of the sea. And we wouldn't know about it if it wasn't for him today. A Bible-believing Christian. Yeah, I know, and you're saying, oh boy, I'm glad I'm sending my kids to a Christian school, though. You need that book, Already Compromised, because it'll show you that most Christian schools aren't even taking a stand on the truth of the Word of God anymore. Carl W. Giberson, professor at Nazarene University for years, said this, quote, unfortunately, the concepts of Adam and Eve as the literal first couple and the ancestors of all humans simply does not fit the evidence. There's no literal Adam and Eve. Wow. How about this? Calvin College professor of religion, Daniel Harlow, said, thus Eden cannot be a literal description of how things really were in the primal human past. Harlow proposed that the understandings of the fall may need to be, quote, reformulated, and the church must be willing to decouple original sin from the notion that all humans descended from a single pair. Got to rewrite the scriptures, guys. And this is at Calvin College. Professor Tremper Longman, Biblical Studies at Westmont College. On his YouTube thing, What Genesis 1 and 2 Teaches and What It Doesn't, says this.
My understanding of Genesis 1 and 2 is high-style literary prose narrative leads me to conclude that it's not necessary that Adam be a historical individual for this text to be without error in what it intends to teach.
Again, we can't believe in a literal Adam and Eve. Or Peter Enns here, formerly from the BioLogos Foundation of San Diego, California, said this in 2011 on Westmont TV.
Who knows if it'll change in the years to come, and I'm still thinking about it. But all the Jesus stuff and all the sin and death stuff are still real. Personally, I don't need a historical Adam to make all that happen.
Or how about this audio here of William Lane Craig? He says young Earth creationism is an embarrassment.
Over 50% of evangelical pastors think that the world is less than 10,000 years old. Now, when you think about that, Kevin, that is just hugely embarrassing that over half of our ministers really believe that the universe is only around 10,000 years old. This is just scientifically, it's nonsense, and yet this is the view that the majority of our pastors hold. It's really quite shocking when you think about it.
With friends like this in our Christian schools, who needs enemies, right? Who needs the evolutionists? It's sad. You know, since 1969, 1,500 churches in the UK have closed their doors. Only 6.3% of their population attend church, and 61% of churchgoers leave by their 20s. We read this in a survey by Pew Forum on religion and public life. The Protestant population has declined from 53% of the U.S. population in 2007 to 48% in 2012. That's just in a few short years. We see the general social survey conducted by the University of Chicago has also shown a downward trend in American Protestantism. According to Pew, Protestants are still the largest religious group in the United States. But what happens when this changes? Followed by Catholics, who make up 22% of the country, and then the unaffiliated, who account for almost 20%. The church is in a decline. Why? I'm going to propose to you evolution. And that's why a godly family is going to be so important. You know, Sunday school has been proven to be damaging. You read this book, Already Gone, by Ken Ham and Britt Beamer. They polled people who left the church to find out why they were leaving the church. And the most shocking thing in there is this, that Sunday school was damaging. If you ask people who went to Sunday school, do you believe evolution is the origin of human beings? 24.6% of those people who left the church who had Sunday school background agreed with that. Yet only 18.5% of non-Sunday school goers agreed. When asked, is premarital sex okay? Sunday school goers, over 59%. No Sunday school goers, 53%. When asked, good people don't need to go to church, it was 39 versus 28%. Is church irrelevant? 46 versus 39%. Across the board, every question asked, Sunday school goers were more likely to be liberal in their thinking. Why? Well, statistics don't give us the why, but I think it's this. You see, it's the same thing that happened to me. When I grew up in a Christian home, I went to church and Sunday school my whole life, but I never learned anything to support the Bible when it came to scientific answers and creation. And when I went to school, these wise professors who had PhDs, they were telling me about anthropology and all these things that I'd never heard before. And I thought, you know what? The church never gave me any answers for these things. I went to church my whole life. They must not have answers to these things. But I think that those people who did not have Sunday school background, they'd sit in that same desk and they'd say, boy, I wish I'd have gone to Sunday school. I wonder what they would have told me about this. I wonder what the church says about it. And so they hold out a little bit longer. This is why a big part of the godly family, I believe, to train your children is they need answers with creation. That's just one part of it. The other thing is those who attended Sunday school were more likely to doubt the Bible was translated correctly, to defend abortion and gay marriage, to believe the Bible was written by men, to believe the earth was older than 6,000 or 10,000 years old, to believe that dinosaurs did not live with man, and to be very anti-church. They also weren't going to churches that were liberal in their thinking. 9 out of 10 were taught the Bible was true and accurate. Only 1 out of 10 were taught that they could believe in evolution. 1/4 of them were told they could believe in millions of years, but God as well. 4 out of 5 said that their pastor said that God created the earth in 6 24-hour days. And only 1/16 were taught that Genesis was a myth, yet they were very liberal in their thought. I'm going to propose to you that kids have questions. They want to know, why is there death, disease, and suffering in this world if God is a God of love? Why is homosexuality such a bad thing? Why can't they get married? If they love one another, isn't God love? They want to know, isn't divorce better than being unhappy for the rest of your life? How can the earth be so young if it looks so old? Why is Jesus the only way? Because I know some Jew or some Hindu who doesn't believe in God, but they're such nice people. Why do dinosaurs have nothing to do with the church? You see, nobody's asking these questions, so they assume no one has the answers. And they think the church people have faith in spite of the facts. We've made Christianity some lofty spiritual thing without any true answers. Let me ask you, are we teaching what the Bible says, but not why we are to believe it? I believe we are. Are we giving kids the message that facts are irrelevant, but faith is not? Don't worry about the sciences. We just have to be spiritual here. Guys, there's more science in your Bible than there is in our textbooks today. Why aren't we teaching our kids this? Are your kids getting the message that if you want to learn something meaningful, you do it at school, but if you want something lofty and emotional, that's you're going to get at church? I think that we have made man the authority over God's word rather than God having the authority in his own word. And by the way, kids weren't leaving the church because of music. Music was not the answer. The statistics show that had nothing to do with it. Many are striving to give entertaining messages to make you feel inspired and all emotional. But I'll tell you something, emotions and feelings fade. Truth stands. In the book Already Compromised that I mentioned, they polled 200 of the most Christian universities around the country to see if they were holding to the inerrancy of the Word of God. And the sad facts are, they're not. Less than a dozen of those churches that were polled passed the test. when asked, do you believe in the inspiration of Scripture, 98% of the presidents and 98% of the vice presidents agreed. So you think, that's great. But when you ask, do you believe in the inerrancy of the Scriptures, the presidents, only 21% said yes, yet almost 78% of the vice presidents. You see, there's an inconsistency in mission and goal here, isn't there? Yeah. Not only that, do you believe the infallibility of Scripture? Only 17% of presidents of these Christian universities, conservative Christian universities, believed it. When you ask, is the Bible literally true? 73% of the presidents, 92% of vice presidents. When asked, do you believe God created in 6 24-hour days? 78% of the presidents and only 40% of the vice presidents. Do you see the inconsistencies? Do you believe the Bible is literally true? 92% of the vice presidents say yes, and then 40% say that God didn't create in 6 24-hour days. Don't think that you can send your kids off to a Christian school and they're going to get a Christian education that holds to the Bible as the Word of God, inerrant, inerrancy, infallible, authority. You're going to need to do that. It's going to begin in the home, because there's a lot of doublespeak going on in the Christian world today and in the Christian universities. Because when you get to the details, do you believe in the flood of Noah's day? Almost all the presidents and vice presidents agreed with that. But when you asked if it was worldwide, only 42% of the vice presidents, 86% of the presidents. When you asked them, do you consider the earth to be young, as the Bible would say, in the religion department, 77% said the earth was old. The science department, 57% said it was old. See, the religion departments have been just as contaminated as a science department. So don't think that if your kids aren't going into some scientific field that they'll be okay. They're not. If I would ask you what the perfect family would be, I'll bet most of you would say it goes something like this. The parents are going to birth the children, and then we're going to see the daycare is going to take care of them while we're at work, teach them to socialize and follow instructions. Preschool is going to teach them their ABCs, possibly, if not at least continue to follow them in their social behaviors. The elementary will certainly teach them their ABCs and prepare them for harder schooling up above. They're going to get their extracurricular activities. Then the high school is going to prepare them for their careers. Their careers will prepare them for their retirement. We're going to see the government alongside that also helping us with our retirement and everything else, right? Yeah, the government's responsibility, not ours. We're going to see the church is going to come alongside all of these stages to help them with their spiritual life. The question I want to ask you is this: what's wrong with this perfect picture of the perfect family here today? Where are we? Where are we? You see, we are always relying on someone else to do what God has asked us to do. So I want to take you to the first family way back in the Garden of Eden to talk about the godly family, because I want you to understand that Adam and Eve were a family even before they had children. Children are simply an added blessing to a family. But the first family is found in Genesis. And you know what we see there? God took Adam and Eve, and He made the two become one flesh. God's math is very different than our math. God's math is 1 + 1 = 1. Today, we have an idea in society that, 1 + 1 = 2 when it comes to a marriage. No, it does not. You give up all selfishness when you get married. Very different. Now, here's the thing. In Malachi 2:15,